Please join me for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome to the August 24th, 2015 Selectmen's Meeting. First, we're going to start with public comment. Any public comment out there? Seeing none, we'll move on to announcements and community calendar. Rusty?
I have nothing.
Mary Louise?
Yes, I want to publicly thank Michael Keefe, who worked for the Public Works Department since 1978. Bless his heart, he has retired for medical reasons, and I think that we as a board should at least draft a letter of thanks or a plaque of some type to present to him to say thank you from the town that he served so well and served basically to the detriment of his health. So I would say that certainly I have known him since he first came to work for the town, and I say thank you ever so much for what he has done for us.
Thank you. Mr. Bean?
I have no comments, sir. Thank you.
Nothing, I'm set.
Okay. Moving on to the consent agenda. Number one is taxi business license application. Number two is another taxi operator licenses for several taxi companies. Number three is parade and public gathering license for the Rotary Club. Okay, I thought.
Reach the Beach.
It's for Reach the Beach.
Reach the Beach. It's the relay on the 19th.
Right. Okay. And number four is one day entertainment license for the 401. Number five is Seawalk Festival.
Seafood
Festival sidewalk vendors. And do we have a.
I'll so move, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Next is approval of minutes for August 10, 2015.
So move.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Our first appointment tonight is Chris Jacobs. Please join us at the table, DPW Director, for a departmental update.
And Jennifer Hale, the Deputy Director, is with him.
Welcome.
Good evening. How is everyone this evening?
Fine, thanks.
How are you?
Good. Glad to be here. For anyone who hasn't met Jennifer Hale, she's my deputy director. And sitting back earlier this evening, I said, what glowing things do I say about her? But all I can say is, initially I go through her with anyone. You go through her interview process and a review process. And I can say that Jennifer fits the job to a T, but the amazing thing is she's brought more skills and enthusiasm and a rapport with the staff that you just don't, I don't think you flush out in an interview process, but she's filling the role very well, very much a team player, and everyone to the person within staff is only good things to say about her and her efforts to date. So I feel lucky to have her.
She's replacing.
She would be replacing me. Yeah. And when I moved into the former director's position, of course it was vacant for about 8 weeks, 8 to 10 weeks that took that long to, if you will, get the advertisement out and prepped, and then of course conduct the interviews. And but Jennifer was the unanimous choice. But no, I'm very pleased to date that she's brought more to the table than even I could have thought. So I appreciate it.
Well, welcome, Jennifer.
Thank you very much.
And she's good with a computer.
Well, that's one of those things, yes. Yeah, very good with a computer. Let's see, I was surprised to see on the agenda today that I was going to give you a departmental update. So that was news to me, but I am prepared. There's always those Okay, I said it. There you go. You can see I don't, well, I'm trying not to carry much paper. It's using the laptop, and it helps keep me online. Let's see, back June 27th, the department received an award from Aquarian Water Company called their Aquarian Environmental Champion Award. It's for doing the things that we've, the tough things that we've had to do the last couple of years with respect to sludge volume reduction, keeping the plant running efficiently, a number of things. And also, I think that, in fact, they're recognizing some of the awards that we've got, well, Wastewater Treatment Plant of the Year out of the New England Wastewater Foundation. They gave us a cash award of $1,000. I've turned that into the manager. I'm sure that'll be on a future agenda for you to accept. But very much appreciate the the recognition. I guess that the work we do is not only valuable to treating the wastewater, but keeping our water supplies clean and efficient. As Mary Louise mentioned, Mike Keith did retire on July 24th. It was kind of sudden. He got some medical news that made him reevaluate where he stood. Mike's worked, when you look back, 37 years
yes.
with the department.
Yep.
Just a wealth of knowledge. But more so than that, every day he brought to the department, he came fully vested every single day. Every day was just, it was another challenge, but it was always to do things right. He wasn't afraid to speak up and say, hey, can we do this better? Can we do that better? He and Bob Walker, the immense knowledge of the things that they've accomplished together over the last 37 years. Some of the houses, they could tell you, oh no, it takes a jog over here and then it takes another jog. Sure enough, they were right. Just invaluable. When Mike did retire, he actually had planned the following week on vacation. And last week when I inquired, could we all get together, he was on vacation again with his family, I believe, up camping. So it's good to hear that while he has some health challenges, that isn't preventing him from using his well-earned time and doing what matters most, and that is spending time with family. We definitely will have him in the fall for one of our quarterly cookouts. And I will extend the invitation to each and all of you. And Mary Louise and I have discussed some possible options of what Mike would appreciate as a parting gift. Not necessarily. I mean, we're not talking the gold watch, because he's not that kind of guy.
Not a plastic pin.
Yeah, exactly. Something with some meaning to it. We do have three new staff members that have started, David Jones, Mike Carell, and a Fletcher Croto, three very nice young men. Two of them are working in the sewer and drain division. They've been down a couple people for most of the summer. One of them started in highway, and we're still in the process of trying to fill the other vacancy within highway. We're also in a process of trying to fill Mike Keith's position. There's been two applicants internally and one externally, and I believe if it's not late this week, it'll be early next week we start that interview process. An overview of the department's budget, we're at right around 58.77%, where I think we're supposed to be at 58.33%. May not sound like much, but when you start, when I took the helm, I had to assume a several hundred thousand dollar over expenditure due to snow, unavoidable. We all worked together to get that done. But what's helped us bring or keep the budget within line to this point has been keeping those positions that we had open or not filled. Mm-hmm. So there's been a salary decline there. Probably the other thing that helped for us was to have to renegotiate our waste disposal contract. Trash has dropped from $73 and change per ton to 60-25. And some of the refuse hauling, that dropped. Well, I know between the first round bidding and the second, one of the vendors dropped his price $50 a trip. The number of trips we take during the summer, that's a big, big gain to the town. My concern, though, is to not let off, to keep tighter control of the budget, because I know that we have to put some reserves together for this winter. What the 58% right on the budget, target budget is, there's, you know, I'm over in one vehicle maintenance line by 16,000, and I'm over in another vehicle maintenance line by 25,000. Mm-hmm. It's not that more vehicles are falling apart. It's, we're still spending the same amount of money we spent the last couple of years. It's just that with a default budget and making some adjustments in our overall budget, it was unavoidable. Give you, for instance, is those sidearm Packer trucks. I think two of them have had to have the front. There's a hydraulic pump mounted right in the front. Two of them have had to have the pump replaced. Mm-hmm. And one of them's had to have a joystick replaced, and it's a $1,500 joystick. Mm-hmm. So while they're efficient trucks, they're not inexpensive to maintain. Our application for the Moose Plate grant to benefit the grist mill was not approved. Apparently a lot of people applying under that program, they did offer some comment back that in the, if we did apply in the future, they'd like to see a lot of letters of support or support from the community. They said the application was a little lacking in comparison to other applications for verified proof that, you know, the residents in fact want this, that, you know, there's 50 people, 100 people, 200 people, or a grassroots committee that's standing behind it. And that's apparently one of the areas where it was short. Other than that, I'm here to talk about asphalt paving and answer any other questions you may have.
Well, I'll take that challenge on, mainly because I had somebody come today, this afternoon, that came in, and really they were very upset about the fact that there's no striping on the road at Exeter Road and the sides where there's needs to be some fill put in or something. Mm-hmm. And particularly the fog lines, because his car went off and he broke his tire rim.
I mean, the same gentleman came down to Public Works and spoke to Teresa,
and he's an old timer, lived here forever, and I think that he brought some valid points. How long do you think that's going to take to fix?
The striping will be done on or about September 8th. The company that we have under contract is racing around like a chicken with their head cut off, but that was the soonest that they could fit us in. When we heard that, Frank and I went out last Tuesday morning?
Mm-hmm.
Thursday morning? Does it? It's a blur now.
It turned into one big day.
He and I went out at 4 a.m. I drove the truck, and he stuck all the reflective markers that you see. I can speak to Al Jones tomorrow, and if we have any white ones, we could possibly go out and stick those on the as temporary fog lines. And the backing up of the pavement, GMI didn't want to start it right after the paving was installed because of the weight of the truck. And they thought that what they'd end up doing is rolling the corners or rolling the edges off, and actually doing more damage to the pavement than it would benefit. But late September, the edges will be all done. They will be backed up. When part of the assessment in going through with the paving was we're holding back. They anticipate it's about $4,000 to $5,000 just to back the pavement up. Mm-hmm. With gravel. They did start last week, because it's going to take about 200 yards of gravel, of pre-stocking it in the rain in our yard, so that it's closer for them to pick up and put in place.
So it sounds like you're really working on this situation, and you do whatever you can
on top
to
of
make
it
this
and
happen.
It, yeah.
Yeah. Mr. Bridle.
Any word on, I contacted you a couple weeks, a month ago now, on the
flashing
flashes, yeah.
I only have one cost estimate back. You and I talked about it on the 17th of July.
Yeah.
But I only have one cost estimate back to so far. I know there's two other vendors out there.
Okay.
And I want to get better, good numbers from them.
Okay, because the school is still interested as far as I know.
Okay.
I'm doing a couple of theirs and hopefully we can find.
This is the department's to-do list spread over six people, so we are keeping track of it.
Thanks.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Ah, yes. Rolling stock. You have a rough estimate when the current rolling stock list will come out? Because I know I've been nagging.
Jennifer can answer that better.
I'm glad.
We walked most of it today, went through the list as we talked about.
Right.
I'm hoping by the end of this week it will be ready to distribute.
Okay. So you'll just get it up to the town office and we'll have it.
Color-coded now and it's broken out by department.
I appreciate that. And you're showing the broken down, busted vehicles.
Right. They're all identified if they've been sidelined
them.
Or
right.
if they...
Because it's critical because we need a full evaluation of the rolling stock in your department. We're spending a lot of money on a lot of equipment and I'd like to see that put in play. Three new employees. I was interested to see that the assistant town manager has performed background checks on all of the new employees, which is good. And obviously those three nice young men passed muster, so you've got three nice employees. Bobby Walker, can you get someone designated out of the department to really partner up with him and start trying to access the wealth of knowledge that that man has before he decides to retire to Bermuda? Or do something else exciting.
I don't think he's up here.
I'm terrified that we will let this go on and on and on, and he is critical to what you're doing down there. So I would like to see that. The Old Farmer's Almanac apparently is forecasting a winter similar to the one we just went through. I know my daughter's a big fan of the Old Farmer's Almanac, and I told her not to bring it in the house. But we'll see. I understand from a friend of mine that there is such a thing for communities as snow insurance. So I'm going to be getting the information together and giving it to Fred. It might not be useful, but then again, who knows? I know that you have a lot on your shoulders. And from my perspective, and I can only speak for myself, we've had a 30-year run of incompetent, unqualified public works directors, and you have reaped the benefits, or otherwise, of the neglect over the years. I have respect for you, and I understand that you have a terrible job facing you. I'm glad Jennifer's on board to help you out. But we've got a lot of ground to make up here. Because we all watch the news, I guess, the last few days and what's happening with the stock market, and people are nervous. And I know Jim has been talking about doing good presentations and making the budget committee happy and so forth on the coming budget. But I'm seeing some belt tightening in everybody's future. And one of the things I discussed with you and the manager last week is sitting down for a serious discussion. A, on offloading the ability of the state of New Hampshire to dispose of their waste through the town. I understand that most of the other public parks, et cetera, have roll-offs from the state, and the state does not impose on the towns for the waste. I think that's got to go. And I think we also need to have a serious discussion on discontinuing commercial waste collection. And I'm very serious about that. I think that we need to take a little different tack, and Chris is going to need to free things up in his budget.
I think the voters have already spoken on
The voters spoke 2 years ago. The voters.
I don't think this board
want us to. Well,
you know, I think that that's.
You're talking about money, and you're interrupting me. You're talking
I
about.
I think that the voters have spoken,
money.
And we're,
voters,
I don't think that we need to be giving directions to the DPW director to get involved with commercial trash.
It's not the public
I think
works,
you're wrong.
It's not the public works director's call. It would be our call. But I think there's a saving in there that
we'll bring it up. But I don't be giving any orders to the.
I'm not giving orders to anyone. I'm just saying that could possibly...
We'll discuss that as a board if we want to go in that direction.
I'm discussing it in front of the board right now.
Okay.
For our budget discussion.
Would you like to see if you
And I would like to not be interrupted.
Would you like to see if we have a consensus to talk about that?
I would like, no. When we have our budget discussion, I will be happy to do that. I'm just throwing an idea out.
I think everybody here on the board heard what the voters said.
The voters said what they said 2.5 years ago, and voters change, times change, and needs
change. And some people don't get the message, and you're one of them.
Oh, I know that. I know that. Now sit still and don't...
Move on.
Don't get... Oh, I am continuing. Don't get yourself in an uproar. Haverhill Ave, Chris, sand problems because the sand does build up. I guess in past years, the Seacoast manager or the state crew would mention if there was a problem with the sand building up on Haverhill Avenue. I am getting complaints from them that they're having a problem with a lot of sand on the roadway. If you guys could take a look at that, I would really appreciate it.
Will do.
And I've also had an inquiry from a gentleman about the resident parking in the Church Street lot. He said there's a maintenance issue there as well. I'm assuming sand or something. And I don't go down there every day, but that would be a good thing to take a look at. And my final thing for you this evening, and you're saying thank heaven, is the asphalt paving bids. I remember in May when Fred announced, and I have both of your bid proposals here, the one from April 27th, and then you just gave us the follow-up on August 20th. I've had questions from people and from members of the Budget Committee on the what seems to be a discrepancy in the bid process. You and I discussed this with about two sentences when I saw you last week. But on the April 27th printout, it shows Fairfield, well, Tuckfield Loop Road, Fairfield, Ruth, and Belmont, and then the Exeter Road. And the bid was $40,538.10 for the Exeter Road. And I remember saying that night that that sounded awfully low to me. And I guess a couple of other members of the board mentioned something in relation to that after that meeting. would you give us a little idea? The backup sheet that you gave us with your August 20th printout, frankly, is a little puzzling to me, and I'm not an expert in bidding out for asphalt. It looks, I don't have a problem with the Fairfield, Ruth, and Belmont figures, but I think we're looking at both linear feet and square yards.
Yep.
And that gets me all frazzled. And Exeter Road is, I believe, 24 feet wide. And I'm trying to figure out how it comes up with the bid figures that I see on this sheet.
Okay. The bid was put together with some thoughts or ideas from the highway foreman.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, the maintenance and procurement person that we had before is no longer with the town.
Yeah.
When they put those items together, I'm not totally sure what they relied on. But for instance, cold planing the surface, we only bid for 1,500 square yards.
Right.
They were expecting only to do where the existing travel way met, for instance, Josephine or St. Cyr, mm-hmm. or in the Bride Hill neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
In reality, what we did was to, in some instances, to get the proper profile, we milled off sections of the pavement. In other areas, we actually shimmed to bring the profile up, or the crown.
Mm-hmm.
So, conversely, instead of just 1,500 square yards, it went up, well, 100,000 fold. We milled off 15,000 square yards.
Okay, so that 1,500 that I see in the cold plan bit surface is 1,500 yards.
Square yards. That's what was bid. That's like a surface area.
Okay.
3 by 3 is a square yard.
So that's not referring to the 1.2 mile length.
Right.
It's the
quantity just for milling.
Okay, quantity for milling.
Same thing with like the wearing course for the machine tonnage.
Mm-hmm.
They must have been anticipating to put it down with a butter knife, which can't really be done. So they anticipated 420 tons, and it took 1,941 tons.
Right.
To do. I think the sum, in other words, all the bid quantities were low. It's the only thing I can, you know, straight out, they were just low. But the true test is, the original estimate put together by CMA was, and their numbers were, you're going to spend $320,000 to get this road done.
Right, because that seems on target from Article 16.
You
had the money.
We spent 311.
Right.
So in other words, their estimate was spot on. But
well, you've got more to spend, don't you, in the few little, the 5,000 or whatever in the finish.
Right, we'd have.
So you're coming right in.
Right, exactly. We're going to come in under the 320 that was appropriated.
What concerns me is that we took the vote to approve the bid process in April. Is that, do we need to retake a vote since we now know? So we're all set on what is actually being spent and the work actually done.
It's actually
done
based upon the number of square yards placed.
Okay.
The amount milled.
So long as we're bidding on apples, when we did our bid, it was apples to apples.
Right.
We have good unit prices, but yes, the quantities of what we actually bought change.
You don't know until you actually get into the road what you're going to be doing.
Hmm. Okay. Because the others look like they're fine, the Belmont and Fairfield and whatever.
Yeah, those were numbers that I had done 2 years earlier, uh-huh, as far as quantities, lengths, and widths.
Yeah.
I had just turned those over to the procurement manager. He inserted those in the bid, and I think that's why they came out.
But I'm really puzzled going over this, and
yep,
then I've gotten a couple of questions, and I'm not good at linear feet and all the other good stuff in there.
I have to admit, I was doing my own projects. He was handling procurement. They're good numbers for the purpose, good quantities for the purpose of bidding.
Mm-hmm.
But I would have liked to seen in that process a better, closer numbers.
Right. A better description so that
description,
we understood the
more
scope.
More accurate, right.
Better. Okay. I appreciate very much what you do, and you've got the hardest job in town. I know, now Fred might compete with you a little bit on that, but truly in my mind, you've got the hardest job in town, and I appreciate what you do. Thank you, Chris.
Oh, thank you.
Mr. Bean.
Great job, folks. I have no questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you. A couple of questions.
One of them.
Number one, the budget, the other said, you know, that you ate the money, the overspend for the snow, that you've been able to handle that. Going forward, do you anticipate any big problems, or, I mean, are you going to be able to eat it for the rest of the year? Are you going to be able to, I mean?
No, I have no budget.
Okay.
Well, I have no budget within respect to snow removal.
Yep.
So, and then when you, and insufficient amounts in the vehicle maintenance, but when a tire falls off, you fix it. Every year the question's going to come back, especially when I get to the budget committee level. Why didn't you spend the $130,000 for sewer maintenance? Why didn't you spend all the $25,000 on trees? And why didn't you spend all the $25,000 on sidewalks? Because I robbed Peter to pay Paul. That's basically it. Going into this winter, we have sufficient, like, I'm not going to allow Frank to order any salt going in, let's say, November 1.
Yep.
He may have salt money in his line, but I may need it for fuel. I'm not going to, we every year gained, we haven't used all the sand that we have in storage. So those are being held. We have sufficient amounts going into the winter. So I don't want anyone to run alarm and run down the street, but I mean, the plow trucks will work, the spreaders will work, there's sufficient sand, there's sufficient salt. Where we take a beating is every time there's an event, we spend about $50,000 between fuel, labor,
lights that don't no longer work on the trucks, windshield wipers that get so clogged with ice they just snap and fall off on the side of the road. Those are the normal things of fighting a snowstorm, and I can't, it snows, we go. And I'll find the money somewhere else. But I don't have, I'm praying nobody reads the Farmer's Almanac. My mother reads it religiously. You know, she's already called me. Oh, my God, you're. She's running down the road with her hands up. Fire. Ma, calm down. We handle it. It's not that bad. But, yeah, so I have to make, you know, I'm not allowing the guys to do much in the way of training. I'm trying to reserve every little pocket and $5 and $10 expenditure so that we can, make it through the winter. When I moved into the office, we thought perfect time. The carpet's been there since 1989, stained 16 ways to Sunday, perfect time to get it replaced. My response back to the other people in the office is, I don't know how I as the director couldn't honestly get my carpet replaced when I asked other people to forego training and other things. So we've all had to bite the bullet, and we're doing it.
I think it's important to say that, and I think it's important for people to realize that even though you're still operating, that there are things not getting done because of it, and that you have to move money around in order to do
it. Right.
So
I'm hoping that the savings to fights to move snow, relocate snow, comes from not an under expenditure in solid waste because of the tipping fee being down, or lower transportation costs, or, as I say, spending sand money on fuel, because I need to fuel the trucks.
Right. Yeah. And one thing, you know, Farmer's Almanac and the old Farmer's Almanac, you know, I researched that. There's no correlation to what happens.
There's two different things.
Yeah, so don't worry about it. It's not going to happen. They're dreaming. Gristmill grant. Was that the gristmill or the dam? Or
It would have been for the gristmill.
Okay. But, I mean, all that effort that went into saving the dam wouldn't help with the...
That's another grant application. Yeah, this was on for a smaller amount, only $10,000. It would have been used to, like, re-roof the gristmill or something of that nature.
All right. So the other thing is, you know, at some point, when you get some time, you and the assistant director, just an overall narrative of how you think things went for the summer and stuff like that, you know, because we're always talking about, as I talked to you about, just getting some figures, we're always talking about there's so much increase in population in the summer, there's so much increase in workload, et cetera, and putting people around. It would be really interesting just to have a narrative of your feelings on how things went and maybe what kind of changes might be.
Well, my target for that was about mid-September, because then we would have the financials in. Mm-hmm. I'd know how much refuse I collected. Even these, like this weekend's expected to be a beautiful weekend. It should be a tremendous weekend for the beach community. As it is, there'll be an extra 100 tons for me in trash. Wastewater volumes have held kind of steady. We've been lucky there. Sludge volume is up a little bit. Smutty Nose is doing great. They're sending us a lot of beer, at least a lot of beer wash. So the economy, you know, that's probably the connection. If the beach community is doing well, the chamber members are doing well, we're doing well. We're receiving it well.
Uh-huh. Just so that you know, everyone thinks it's a bad summer. Business is actually not as good as it was last year. There's a lot of people here that are here for the day, but there's a lot of people that are not happy with how business is actually. Mm-hmm. There are some people that are, but it's not. I know everyone thinks that, but that's not the consensus of what's happening at the beach.
So
it'd be interesting to see how much room and meals tax they get this year, if it's up over last year or not.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm sure that there's plenty of business for you with all the people that
come.
When I see the
cars stacked up, when I see the photo of how packed it was, I say, it's going to be a good weekend, trash wise.
Well, it is, because whether they're there for the week or they're there for the day.
Are you finished?
There's 100,000 people there. There's still 100,000 people whether they're there for the day or the week, so you're still going to have all that trash.
Yeah. Jim, were you finished?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, and I wanted to mention, I haven't had my time to talk yet. I would like and I was going to ask Fred about this, but I now I'm going to be able to ask you, ask Fred, and ask Ed Tinker about it. Again, I had another person come today from 36 Ocean Boulevard, and this is the guy that seems to be saying that he's taking in water into his home in the basement level. Nancy Stiles has been working on this, and he's very happy with everything that Nancy's done for him. In fact, she says she's the only person that's helped at all. And he is claiming that the road, and I guess it's, he says Ocean Boulevard, so I don't...
Right side?
Right side headed north.
Yeah, and he's got an apartment in the back with a low entrance.
And he's...
former owner should have told him this. That was...
Is the guy a new owner? Because he owns maybe other properties there too. I'll have to...
He's not the same person that I dealt with two summers ago.
He isn't.
Because every time...
I think he has other property, though.
Was predicted, he would be the only person to get sandbags from us during the summer. He would take the sandbags and line them across the driveway. Because when it rained, it would build up enough. He's got a little, what I call a jump on at the end of the driveway to hold the water on the on the state road. And it jumps that, comes down the driveway into the entryway for his basement apartment or basement unit.
And what is he talking about drains in front of the place or something?
The catch basins along the street belong to the state. They're not maintained by the state. They don't vacuum them out or jet them. They eventually do connect to ours. Ours are all free and running down O Street, P Street. That's the section he's in. He's in that southern section. But, yeah, I know the house...
Now, does this have anything to do with the town?
Sadly, no.
No. Because this is the type of question I'm going to ask Mr. Tinker about, is I think this piece is directly next door to a piece of property that's coming on about a buying a piece of leased land. And I think there's some issues there. I mean, I'm hearing that people feel that their properties are devalued. And I think this is something that we're going to have to take a look at, because this could happen all along Ocean Boulevard in many, many places. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this is, I think, a critical situation. And it's pretty bad, you know, that we have to come up with a plan of how we deal with these people. I know many people that don't complain that have issues. And... So this is one more reason why we have to do something about what's happening with Ocean Boulevard and the drainage system down there. But I didn't realize that gentleman was a new person for that piece of property.
Not the same person I dealt with 2 years ago.
So I will ask him about that.
Yeah.
Okay, Mrs. Wolseley?
In light of that, didn't the state reconfigure the area, Fred, a couple of years ago?
They reconfigured their outfall into the ocean. But it doesn't serve the area that Chris is talking about.
Because I thought something the state had done was, because I heard somebody say something the state had done.
When they fixed their drainage because of the new construction that they did at the beach, they adjusted their outfall, but it's not in the area that Chris is talking about.
Oh, okay.
So what do you mean new construction?
When they constructed the facilities at the beach. There were drainage issues there, and they already had a drain that went out into the ocean, and they reoriented that to take into consideration their new parking lots and so forth.
Mm-hmm. So. Does this have anything to do with this gentleman's issue at all?
No, it's further down the street.
That's what I was wondering.
But, I mean, how long has this gone on?
Well, I think Chris will tell you that the average reveal on a piece of curb is 6 to 7 inches. And those curbs are below the street pavement. So based upon that, considering how often the state repaves their roads with real pavement, this has probably been going on for 20 years.
So this man should just expect that his unit should have water in it all the time?
Well, until they reconstruct the road, there's no way to divert that water.
So this is just one of many, many issues with the drainage on Ocean
Boulevard. They also have to clean the drainage. That would help a lot. Mm. But they don't do that either.
So. Back real quick for my follow-up. Air handling system at the wastewater treatment plant, is that all done yet?
No, their units are on order.
Okay. Just let us know when, when you got clean air.
Okay.
Do we have any other business going here tonight?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
They would like to talk about additional work under bid 2015-3 asphalt paving.
Want to talk about that?
Yeah, the next road that was identified for paving, if we had the money left over, was Toll Farm Road. Basically from where the new Toll Farm Road pump station is out all the way to the town line. Frank's pretty optimistic that he can get to the town line. I'm going to watch his checkbook really closely, and the minute the money's done, he's done. So we discussed it with GMI. They'd still hold the same unit prices that we had before. Matter of fact, they've adjusted them actually down lower, the unit prices for milling and asphalt per ton, because of the amount of work that the town's been giving them this year. So we're asking, there's 170, what's left over is, there was 267,000 and some change in the Warren article to take this state highway aid
grant
money, grant money, and use it for paving. We used it for Fairfield, Ruth, Belmont. Took up about 90 to 100,000. That leaves us 172,864 remaining. We'd like to use 167 of that and $267.50 to resurface Toll Farm Road. In discussing it with the manager last week, I was personally more comfortable if I came here and asked you to extend the contract, if you will, another amount with GMI, and especially so because it was $167,000 worth, and that's why I'm here.
Okay, questions, Mr. Bridle.
Traveling that road every day, hearing the trucks that run up and down that road every day, which shouldn't be there. That road is long overdue. Yeah. Long overdue. You guys have done an excellent job out there patching. But when you start putting patches on top of patches on top of patches, all you get is when the rain comes, it digs it out. So that road is long overdue for being done.
Yeah.
I mean, no, I've mentioned it to Fred a couple of times, but some of the property that we own near the Campbell Road, it would be nice if we could clear that back a little bit. And I know we don't probably have the money this year, but maybe think of it next year. Is because that part freezes a lot, because it is very shaded all winter long, and it stays shaded, and so it stays icy and stays cold, and that also helps to, that's part of the worst part that's broken up.
Well, I did agree with the manager to at least get a price, and if, you know, two winters ago, we had the October storm, and then nothing through November and December.
Right.
That's the storm I'd like to have that I'm praying for, or the early winter season. If we have that kind of winter season, it would allow me to go in there and have those trees removed.
I just think it would open that up a little bit, let it get dry, let it dry, that road dry out, and I think it would help.
Totally agree.
Keep that road, so I'm totally for it.
Mr. Waddell, we'll go your way. Nothing? Mrs. Wilsley?
Yeah. Any underpinnings in this whole area? Now, you're talking about the bridge, from the bridge on, because the beginning of Toll Farm, well, actually over the bridge is Smutty Nose.
Right.
There are no sewer lines to replace. There aren't any water lines out there. You're just doing the road.
Right. The closest to water is down at Drakeside Road and Toll Farm, but Quarren hasn't brought that around the corner yet, and when they do, they want to be off the pavement when they extend the water main. We've discussed it with them already.
So the least expensive roads at this point in time are the ones that don't have the deteriorating sewer and all that stuff under them.
Right, there's no...
So this is just a road.
Right, there's no infrastructure in there for us to be concerned about to have to prep before we go down the road.
Mr. Bean?
Can I get a chop from Mr. Welch on that?
I had suggested that the department do this road. Because of the condition, I've looked at it. It's pretty bad. We can't do from bridge to bridge because there isn't enough money. I think you're probably going to have going from Mary Batchelor Road down to the town line. Mm-hmm. I think we've got enough money for that. It appears to be enough money for that. They'll have to grind some of that. They're going to have to pay, grind it off and...
Some of it gets shimmed, some of it gets ground, resurfaced.
It's a combination.
Both.
But I think we can do it for the $167,000 he has, and you're still planning on paving, saving $30,000, for,
Teresa has the bid documents for crack sealing on Lafayette Road.
Okay.
Whatever's remaining, that would be the amount inserted in there. Crack seal till that's done, and then we're done.
Okay.
We've identified Lafayette Road that it's still of a high value from the Northampton town line coming south. Crack seal that, it'll hold it together for a number of years, several, three or four, while we work on some of these other roads. But eventually that will need to be resurfaced.
If you don't reseal that now, you're going to be resurfacing that next year or two. It's pretty bad, so.
Okay, and just one second, Selectman Wolsey, please, Mr. Chairman, just going on. So is that something that, you approve of doing this year with funds that are within the budget?
I do.
And does that require a motion?
I believe it does, yes.
Okay. So I support that in fixing that road, and, I'll go back to you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Okay, Mrs. Wolsey?
Really quickly, I seem to recall that there have been priority lists for paving created by Public Works over the years.
Old Farm was in my CIP for next year.
Right.
Okay, so remember when that list was updated roughly?
8 weeks ago.
Oh, okay, because I wasn't sure. Well, sometimes there's a gap, you know, 2 or 3 years go by.
When we get this done, it'll mean I start from the, again, to reevaluate the whole list.
Okay, excellent.
They're doing this on a regular basis.
Okay. I just seem to remember that we produced
one.
You're
right, yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Good.
Now, Fred, I wanted to ask you, because I'm just sitting here thinking in my mind, is, you know, the problem that came up about the state, about the sidewalks at that, it's right around that 36 Ocean Boulevard. It's across, is it across the street?
Across the street.
Across the street.
Yeah.
At 47.
And what about, how does the water go on their side? Which way does it drain out to? Does it drain to the east?
Everybody on that side is actually facing a bowl. If you went out in the very back of those properties, when it rains really hard during the summer, they'll have a nice 1 foot deep swimming hole. But none of them have any building improvements out there. Yeah. It's all visitors' lawn, if you will.
Yeah.
And they tell me that hour after the thunderstorm goes by, it's gone. So, but eventually, you know, you look at those properties, or I do the same way, that they're eventually going to get improved and re-improved. And at some point, we're going to face the music there. Or everybody fills in their backyard and we do it differently.
Mm-hmm.
But I have the ability there to handle the drainage.
Does the land by any chance sink? You know how some places the land seems to be sinking? Like where that, on the side of the street where 36 is, does that land actually sink down because of just as time goes on?
Not that, you know, a place like Mexico City, 36 feet lower than it was 100 years ago. Mm-hmm. But that's because they're sucking all the water out of the...
It's built on all filled land, Mexico City.
I haven't seen any indications of subsidence in that area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, if we lost the bottom of a pipe or the basin was floating in air, then that would might be an indication.
So the sandy soil sort of holds its own?
It appears to be holding its own.
Mm-hmm. Mm, very interesting.
So do we need a motion, Fred?
Mr. Bean made a motion, and I'm waiting for you to second it.
I just asked.
He asked the question.
If you can frame that, it's up to the chairman, but if you want to proceed with that motion, if you could word that, I'd be happy to make that motion. For the 167 for Toll Farm Road.
You have a definite figure you're using?
167, 267, and 50 cents.
167, 257?
267.
267.
And 50 cents.
In that case, Mr. Chairman, I would suggest to you that the motion should be that the Department of Public Works be authorized under bid 2015-003 asphalt paving to spend at those rates $167,267 on Toll Farm Road for paving.
So moved.
Second.
And that's under the grant. That's with the balance of the grant money.
That's, well, bid 2015, oh, that's the only money we have.
Right.
There is no other money for paving, right.
Okay.
Any other discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you for coming in tonight.
You almost made it.
You knocked, almost made it out the door. Mr. Chairman, I would suggest to you that as long as the director is here and the deputy director is here, that under new business item number one. High Street and Lafayette Road drainage contract, permission to do night work, should be discussed with the director here.
Okay.
Which night?
A few.
Okay, so did you wanna, who would like to speak with it, you or the director?
Jennifer's,
Wanna join us, Jennifer?
I'm thinking that's how it's gonna go. So we met with the contractor earlier this week, and Jamie and Fred and CMA, and tried to put together a plan here. We're looking to start middle of September on this work. For anybody that's not intimately aware, this drain line runs along the side where Cohen's and the new coffee shop is. There's two catch basins to collect there. Hits dead center the intersection of High Street and Lafayette, and then comes down Lafayette, again, almost dead center, and then takes a, I'll call it a right, since I'm going southbound here, into Kitchen, into the Depot Square, and then out to the back towards the railroad. So when you're looking at doing this construction, we all know what we saw and what we experienced when we were just paving Exeter Road, and that's without having excavation equipment, trucks in the middle, trying to load them. The contractor, you know, has said, hey, I mean, will you guys consider night work? And we talked about it at length and at no additional cost to the town, which I think that's actually a benefit, because a lot of times when you do that, there is a cost. That with all the businesses that we have in that area, from those within the depot, from those that have their parking along both sides of the road, including, you know, from Morelli's, the jewelry store, the hair place, all the way down to Greg's and, you know, the other side with the Thai restaurant, and then Hagen's, and, you know, for that matter, Old Salt, and those that are also within the square, that having through traffic, being able to get through the intersection, all directions, east, west, north, and south during the day, is really going to keep this up and running, keep the town up and running. The night work, yes, it would be at night, and there's, you can't silence it. I mean, that it's an honesty thing here. They're looking at a three-week construction period. So the hours that are being considered would be in slightly before 8 to get equipment going and running, and everything would be closed up and buttoned by 5 a.m. And so that's, you know, that's really the short story to, when you think about, once we hear from you guys and your thoughts, putting together that plan with police, with fire, with the contractor, knowing, you know, what time of day we're doing it, what detours we're going to need to set, and how this traffic patterns would actually work.
Okay, questions. Mr. Bridle?
I happened to be in Morelli's today, and well, this was obviously a topic of discussion that came up.
Badger wife.
And quite frankly, to the Morelli's that were there that I were talking to, they would much rather see it happen at night, and because of the complications. Mm-hmm. One concern I I know that going down through Depot Square, we're going across the right of way.
Right.
Have we discussed with the gentleman that owns that property and kept him aware and kept him in the loop of what's going on?
The discussion started about a year ago.
So he's...
The guy's name, I want to say Brown. And
yep, Stan Brown.
Stan Brown, okay. And we met his son.
Yep.
Frank and I actually met his son upstairs in the lobby. Not planned, but that's the way it worked out. He reminded me that that's all he had was an easement. Went into this historical dissertation about monies in the past and dealings, but he made it clear that do it right, get it done once and be out. his concern was for the businesses that you know, for instance,
Ron's
Kitchenette.
Yeah. Eastro.
Kitchen Depot,
thank you. That, you know, businesses like theirs would suffer egregiously for daytime work.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Not for, you know, certainly not for the portion that's up on High Street or even coming down the middle of Lafayette, but when we turn right and go right down in front of them in Depot Square, mm-hmm. they'd suffer. So he thought that would be something that we should explore. He thought that a year ago.
Well, I just want to make sure that, you know, we're keeping Mr. Brown involved in discussions.
And we have every intention of actually doing a neighborhood meeting. I add that on because it's hard to go talk to everybody and tell them what you're doing until you actually know what you're
absolutely.
Doing.
Absolutely, but I think, you know, we're long Cohens and stuff like that. That's one of the reasons why we're doing this, so they've got to understand that we're doing this because to protect their building.
Yes.
And I'm sure Mr. Jackson understands that. He's the owner of that property on that whole corner. So I don't think you'll have any problem or any issues. I think it's much better to deal with traffic at night after 8 o'clock to 5 o'clock in the morning than it is from 8 o'clock in the day till 5 o'clock at night, especially in the downtown part of Hampton.
It'll probably just be the Sunday through Thursday night period.
I think this is a much better way to handle it than... Yes, it is going to inconvenience a few people,
mm-hmm.
No doubt about that. But I think it's better off for our community as a whole to get it done at that point in time.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Yeah, this is starting from the base of Dearborn Avenue going west?
No.
No.
No, you don't have to go for that far back?
Hagen's no. Grill out to the intersection. Or is in front. In front of Zesto's. That area.
Okay, all right.
Across the hardware store, out to, to the intersection, then down to Depot Square.
I
have
to go quite as far as I thought.
Right.
Now, since that's such a narrow area and you're going to have all the construction stuff, any talk about using part of the town parking lot? And I don't know how full that is at night because I'm not usually by there in the evening, but is there going to be any plan for some where they can put gravel or whatever? Has anybody discussed the possibility?
We've already arranged for a staging area.
Okay.
For the contractor.
Okay. For the contractor.
Yeah. Yeah, I think night is a smarter thing to do.
And in the past, we've worked with, I know, across the street from Greg's attorney Caputo's office.
Mm-hmm.
We had some issues, like, for instance, we wanted a tree taken down, and he lost 5 parking spaces for the day. I ended up, with Fred's blessing, ended up writing individual notes that they could put in the window that for short term. If we have to do something like that for some of the residents or something else, we'll get it done.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, because I think night is smarter.
I don't want to see the least impact as possible to the businesses.
Mm-hmm.
Should also shorten the construction time.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Definitely. Yeah, good.
Mr. Bean?
Under Roman 8, new business, number 1, High Street and Lafayette Road, drainage contract, permission to allow night work. I so move.
Second.
He didn't get to talk
Well,
yet,
there's discussion, so go ahead.
Although,
thanks.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
And then you can talk after.
How many residential people are there in that area?
That we're trying to get our hands on. You have the residents in the stories above Cohen's and Mr. Jackson's building. You have the greenhouse at the corner and into the town lot. You have homes or residents above the Pad Thai restaurant. That's what you have centrally for residents.
Cargo
right
block. There's
and then as you come down around the corner.
Flower shop, there's an apartment.
Apartment above
that.
Them. You know,
yeah. A couple apartments in Stan Brown's building.
Yeah, I agree 100% for the businesses and for the convenience, but we have to do something for the residents. I don't know what we can do because I know during the school year I see kids out there waiting for the bus and stuff. And, you know, if it's all night long that construction's going on and you have kids living in those apartments trying to sleep, and I know it's hard to mitigate the noise, but I think we ought to take that into consideration and really do something to work with those people to try to come up with a solution that would help them.
Reach out to them in the community.
Not much in that area.
Janet, and I forget her last from, or Karen from Morelli's Market.
Karen came in the other
day. She said, I'm just going to go with friends for for a couple of days, you know?
Yeah, well, I know I see kids down there waiting for the bus during school year, and that's, yeah.
Jamco can just be careful about slamming tailgates and...
Well, it's probably it's a slamming tailgate or a backup alarm is probably the biggest things
that are going to be the noise.
Pierce the night.
That'll be done. That could be done.
Did you have anything else, Mr. Wardell?
No, thank you very much for letting me speak.
Okay, so we have a first. Did we have a second?
I'll second.
Okay.
I second.
All those in favor?
What are you doing?
And against?
I voted.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Unanimous. Thank you very much.
Can we leave, Mr.?
Anything else?
Oh, please.
Unless you talk about some other things.
I went to Mexico City about a month after that when they had their major earthquake, and it was the most interesting thing, but all because the sides of skyscrapers just came flying down because it was all built on filled land and sinking, like you said. Thank you for coming in and welcome.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, can we move Wounded Warrior next?
Yeah.
That would be good.
Yeah, you want to join us? Mr. Patella?
Good evening. Nice to see you all again.
See you, Ralph.
Well, the 8th annual Wounded Warriors Hit the Beach is this Friday. And this, I know I've said this before, but this year is clearly going to be the biggest year we've ever had. I've been in contact with the Wounded Warrior Project director in Boston, and they have 45 signed up coming from there. The New England Disabled, the warfighters up in New Hampshire, have 13, and there are 10 from other non-organizations, just veterans who are just kind of out there and been wounded and want to just, you know, come by. So that's 68 participants this Friday. It's going to be sunny. There's going to be surf. The water temperature is way up. It's 68 in the high 60s. It's really nice. I've been getting a lot of calls from people just because it was in the Hampton Union for volunteers. We need volunteers in the water. We don't need people on the beach. Just, you know. So we need, you know, people that can deal with, because the surf is going to be up somewhat, even though we have soft tops. A lot of the people that don't surf, they stand in the shallow water and pick up the boards when they fall off. We even have, I forgot to mention, we even have one person who's blind who's coming.
Oh, that's great.
So, I mean, it's going to be an interesting day to say the least. But as always, we would like to ask if it's okay if we had parking in the town parking. We are basically going to
do it every year.
Yeah, you know, take over that whole section of this beach. I mean, it's just, there's no way of getting around it. We're going to set up a perimeter. The state has been really good to us, though, so it's going to be really good. There's no seaweed down there right now. There's zero seaweed. So down on across of Place Cove, the real Place Cove, there's nothing down there. So that's been really, really good for us. All it takes is one big storm, though, and that stuff comes in. And
don't mention it.
Yeah, there's one coming, so
yeah, I know.
I'm hoping it's the day of, you know. But other than that, we have a bunch of volunteers. Cinnamon Rainbows is providing all the soft tops. Pioneers and Zapsticks and Seabrook and Summer Sessions and Rye. So we've got more than enough volunteers and people helping out. The fire department, I think, will bring their garrison flag. Colonel, do you know what a garrison flag is?
Stand by.
The garrison flag is the largest American flag that we have. And I found that out myself when walking to, we were marching to Chow one day in boot camp. The drill instructor said to me, Private, you know what that is? You know what kind of flag that is? I said, sir, it's an American flag. Boom! Hit off the top of my head. Said, it's a garrison flag. And from that day forward, I never forgot. The garrison flag is the largest flag we have. But other than that, I think we're good to go. I just wanted to let you know, but we're going to basically take over that section from 18th Street down to the bathhouses and probably up to 16th Street. Lifeguards are gone, so there's no surf area, per se. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for one day, it might be an inconvenience for someone who wants to hang on the beach. But most of the people really enjoy it, so it's not like we're, you know, ruining something for them, a vacationers or something.
What day is this again?
Friday.
This Friday?
This Friday.
What time?
Nine.
From 9 to 3. I sent out an email, did you all get it?
I got it, yeah.
I just didn't have it with me, so. So it's this Friday, I don't have the email with me.
Can't remember anything.
So it's, no, I had the email, I just don't have it with me. I just want everybody out in the public to know that it's this Friday.
This Friday.
9 to 3.
Yep, August 28th. And if I may, you know, so there's gonna be, you know, it's gonna be an event, basically, you know? It's so good for the town, I mean, it really is good for the town.
Do a wonderful job.
If you get that kind of publicity, New Hampshire Chronicle is coming down.
Good.
So, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that's happening, and it's good for Hampton, you know, to keep this up. It's our 8th year doing this, you know? So like I tell the guys before they head out, the men and women who were wounded, I quote Robert Duvall in his famous Colonel Kurtz role in Apocalypse Now. If I say it's safe to surf, it's safe to surf. And with that, is there any questions or concerns or anything?
Questions for Mr. Fitello.
No, Frank, you've done, I mean, you've done a great job with this.
Yeah.
Ralph.
Thank you.
That's nice. Frank, sorry. You've done a great job with this for 8 years.
Yeah, thank
it's
you.
It's a class act.
Yeah.
You have a class participation with this. The American Legion's done a great job with this, but you personally, I know, have put a lot into this.
This is my baby.
It is. It is. And you should be extremely proud of it because you've done an excellent job.
Thank you.
I think it's a great, great event for the town.
I'm sure you're going to find you have the support of the Board of Selectmen on this. It's a great thing, and we appreciate everything that you do.
Absolutely.
Mrs. Wolseley?
No, it's just great. Great job.
Well done,
Mr. Paul. Bean and Mr. Waddell.
Good job.
Good night.
Thank you. We appreciate it. Next, we have Mr. Tinker.
Good evening, Ed. Here this evening to, I presented the MS-1, the 2015 MS-1. Represents the taxable value that the 2015 tax rate will be set on. Which will give you a little information, but first let me just give you the total taxable value this year. Has increased by just about $8.3 million. To $2,790,275,600. A few things that took place this year that represent that $8.3 million increase. We initially had projected about $48 million in increase. But one thing we did need to do initially was remove approximately $31 to $32 million from the assessing side to the income side as a result of a pilot agreement we made with NextEra Energy as a result of one of our pending appeals in 2014. A couple other things that took place had to do with, of course, this past winter. We had a substantial amount of new construction that was underway. And because of that slowdown during the winter months, we didn't realize about $8 to $10 million that was not able to get onto the books for 2015. It will result in being an addition in 16, the first tax bill. However, that what isn't realized this year as part of the tax rate setting. So based on those things, as well as a few other adjustments we made as to some settled appeals, our permit work, our cyclical work, our sales review resulted in the net increase of $8.3 million. And if you have any questions or anything you can
questions for Mr. Tinker, Mr. Bridle.
No, all set, thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yeah, Ed, as we're in the preliminary stages of the reval on-site inspections and clarifications and so forth, none of that is factored in here that will show next year, is that?
Well, the cyclical work and the sales inspections, when we do make those, if there's any factual information or measurements or bedroom count, bathroom, those things get corrected immediately.
Oh, okay.
Anything that is new or needs to be looked at as to a relationship between assessment and sale price that has to wait until we complete the revaluation.
That's okay.
So there'll be two things next year. Not only do we have the reval going on, but we have a large amount of new construction that began even this year that we haven't picked up yet.
So as of April 1st next year for the new construction, we should be able to get that factored in.
Right. The first tax bill of next year will show value associated with the remaining completion of those projects from last year,
right,
as well as the projects that are underway now. Hopefully they'll be completed by April 1, but at whatever point they are, yeah, that'll be added, as well as the increase based on the revaluation.
Okay. Yeah. Good. Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
Just that utility number's huge. That's over $600,000 in income. That's a give back. That's not dead yet, but that's a huge negative cash flow. And thank you for your work.
And Mr. Waddell?
Yeah, thank you, Ed. And the reval's going pretty well?
Yeah, basically right now it's the sales review and the cyclical work. Vision will be on site beginning in September, and we'll start to begin the analysis to update the system, the canvas system, with the new work on the new tables, and move forward so we have new values, preliminary values, early next spring, early summer.
Okay, and as already been said, I mean, next year looks like with the new construction, with the reval,
yeah, I mean,
it should be a good year.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably going to be somewhat of a catch-up year. This year was more of a clearing of a lot of past issues with abatements and appeals, as well as, you know, pilot programs. So, you know, hopefully next year, with both things going on, that we'll see a substantial increase based on all of those factors.
Hey, yeah, I got nothing else. Thank you.
Yeah, and, you know, one thing that I wanted to ask is, now, when you have areas like that down there at 36 Ocean Boulevard, mm-hmm, how does that affect the value when the state doesn't keep up the drains or maintain the roadway? Does that affect the value of our properties here in Hampton?
Well, It depends a little bit, and I think that area, being what it is, being the location to the water, proximity to the ocean.
Yeah, but that has nothing to do with this water.
No. But based on the all of those factors, the drainage, the limited lot sizes, the lack of anywhere for the water to go when it becomes a heavy rain, a real quick rain, I think there's a problem with drainage more so than just those drains. But what we try to do when we value those properties, again, based on market value, we complete the value we produce has a lot of factors associated with it. The size of the lot, the location of each property in proximity to the ocean, a site index relative to almost specific sections of that area. So I think that when heavy water or heavy rains come and you see issues with some people having standing water in their yards or in their driveway. I mean, we've had that issue on Kings Highway as well. I remember going out to a couple of properties where the water collects at the beginning of some driveways.
But this goes right into the man's house.
Oh, it does.
I mean, this is a big problem. This is an older gentleman. I mean, I'd love to be able to tell him something. Do you know if that property has multiple buildings on it?
36?
36.
Offhand, I don't.
Yeah. Do you know, Fred?
I don't.
No. And you don't know what the size of it is?
A lot of those lots that are
small. Some of them are.
They're below, yeah, they're basically about 4,000 square feet, if that.
I think some of them are smaller than that.
Correct.
But is 36 that type of a lot, do you know?
The lots down that area, most of them are small. They're not overly large lots.
Yeah. So they're configured a little differently.
One of the things that needs to happen here is that when the property is inspected, the owner of the property needs to call that to the attention of the person inspecting the property so that can be factored into the evaluation.
Yeah.
I mean,
like they want to do that.
the problem with valuing or addressing, and I'm not talking about 36 specific, I'm just talking about in general terms, that if there's drainage issues that affect several properties in a neighborhood, really the adjustment's already being made in the neighborhood adjustment, the site index adjustment, based on the size. There's also a size factor. There's and the location, the neighborhood location. A lot of that's already factored in. If it's specific to just one property where somebody built next to them that's causing an issue, that's affecting their market value, that's a different situation. It's really hard when you have an area where more than one is seeing drainage issues. Mm-hmm. If you start making adjustments to individual properties, you've got to make it to...
So what happens if, is that a private issue that goes to court if it's a person that, like what you just said about someone building next to somebody? What does a person like that have?
Well, I mean, if it's caused by an abutter that does something that's, not approved or is illegal?
No, just something that's, they haven't had the due justice of, it hasn't worked out like it was supposed to for them. I've heard a lot of people here come and say that, you know, different things have been done and makes water go into their...
Right, right.
Yeah.
And that's the thing, is like I'm saying, it's not just centered on one property.
No, all along Ocean Boulevard, there's severe problems.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, I think the market value of the sales that take place indicate the value of those lots based on those issues. I mean, if there's a high tide, you can look at Island Path. Island Path gets covered in water during a full moon. People can't pass. They have to wait for the tide to go down to get home or to leave their house. So we factor all those in when we do the analysis and come up with our factors. Like I said, if it's specific to just one property within a neighborhood, you know, we can look at that. But if it becomes a bigger picture, by doing individual adjustments really isn't the way to do it.
Mm-hmm. It's a whole. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Now, do we need a motion here?
I don't believe so.
No.
Thank you, Ed.
It's a statutory requirement.
Okay. Thank you, Ed, for coming in tonight. We appreciate it, and thanks for earlier. What is the young person back there?
Just a visit.
Just a visit.
See what's going on.
Okay. So next we have
Brian
joining us. Thanks, gentlemen in the back that are going out right now. We appreciate you came in tonight. Thank you.
All right. Well, a couple years ago we were going to put a studio in the two firehouses. One is going to be the main one was going to be up the main was going to be an EOC center. Turned out that wouldn't work out because of the room where it was. The fire chief didn't like the idea of having it in there. So anyways, we were going to put one down in the precinct, and we had a bid and we brought it forward and the bid was kind of high. So we kind of tabled it. So we were going back to that, and hopefully with the cuts we made, we were able from going from $17,000 to around $8,000 for the room using existing equipment and some new equipment. And the reason we want to put one down there is that the precinct has their meetings there once a month, and so does the HBAC, AC also has some meetings down at the police station. We've moved that equipment over to the precinct and then be able to have one location. It also would serve as a room. If this room would become unavailable due to flooding or whatever, we could have a meeting down there. And I was told by Paul Parquette that we could do it live with a little bit of work, but I've got the permission from both Chief Ayotte and the Beach Commissioners. They're fine with it, letting the town use the room if need be, if with just giving it some notice. So I just thought it'd be something, or we did as a committee, thought it'd be something that would be of value to the town to have a second location. It'd be a minor studio, nothing like what we have here, just a couple of cameras. And we'd be located in the adjoining utility room. And it would keep our guys out of the room, more room for, if you've been down there, Rick, you know it gets crowded in there.
I was going to say, it's really small.
It's really small, and our guys take up at least 4 or 5 seats. And they don't, it's not a great camera angle, the sound is okay. We only have four mics there. This way we could use the existing wireless mics that we don't use here anymore or at the police station, and we could put up to 8 or 9 mics. So it would be a lot, you'd have better sound, better picture, you'd be in the other room, and like I said, it'd be a backup to this location. And we'll be using gear that we don't, it's just sitting here doing nothing. So if you got the I sent you the bids, the equipment total would be $6,722, and then the install, because it has to be installed professionally, at least the wiring, and that was a Chief Ayotte definitely wanted it done by a professional, would be around $1,600, and that'd be done by Access AV, who does all the work here. We just think it would be an asset to the town to have a second location.
So it's a total of 6,700?
It would be a total of, I'm sorry, let me put my glasses on, 8,322.
And it would come out of the?
The cable fund, which is around 70,000 right now.
Okay, well, let's have a discussion of that. Mr. Bridle.
Well, I think it's time we have a second studio. I think he needs the, it gives us a backup for this one in case anything did happen down here. At $8,300, coming out of the cable fund that we already have the money for, it's already taken. I think it's well worth the money to do. I know that they have worked hard to keep the cost down. You know that room is very crowded when they have to be there with their portable equipment, and it takes a small room and makes it even smaller, and this would alleviate that problem.
Right, it'd be a better picture. It'd just be a better production.
So I've got no problems with this at all.
Are you comfortable with the fund being that low? That's the lowest I've ever heard it.
Well, if it goes too much higher, then it's too high. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing, which is improving. Mm-hmm. So I don't think this is like the only expenditure I could see in the near future.
Right.
Had it just be maintaining.
Yep.
This is it. This is all I can say.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Wolseley?
Has the leak in the roof, Fred, at the beach station in the stairwell area on the right, east end, has that been corrected?
Well, I know that I'm diligently working on it, but I haven't. Nobody's passed a piece of paper to me yet saying it's completely.
It's still working on it? Because at the head of the stairs, if I recall, that's where the precinct meeting.
Yeah, but it's nothing.
It wouldn't have any offset.
No,
nothing would affect you.
No,
there.
No, there's no water coming into where the equipment would be. It's
I like the idea of the extra microphones. I hate it when I'm watching something and I can't hear people. It drives me crazy. And actually, the sound quality here too. I know you've had Comcast in with you, whatever.
Well, no, Comcast.
But I think the sound quality in our broadcast certainly could use some enhancement, and I don't know how you do that, but that's another thing.
No help from Comcast on that. That
drives me crazy.
Yeah. Well, I know it was about the budget committee, and we're going to add more microphones. That's all we can do.
Yeah. But, I mean, even with us, there are times I turn on, I'll see a rerun, and it's hard to make out what people are saying.
It's since we've moved that unit, we have that unit from Comcast, it's been hard. It's been very difficult to keep it. Just so, and everybody's different. When you raise your voices, it has to be toned down, and like I said, Comcast has not been any help. So,
Mr.
One more quick one. Any effect on the precinct annual meeting? Because last year, the precinct commissioners were standing there holding, the microphone.
Well, I'm going to change that. We've talked about that. We're not going to use boundary mics there because of the speakers in the room. We found that out with the.
Yeah.
With the town meeting itself, he was using the professional audio guy was using boundary mics, and it just reflects off the speakers. So they'll have to, we'll have to change that. They won't be, we won't be using.
So we should have better sound quality for the annual precinct meeting.
It's tough in that room.
That has nothing to do with this, though.
No, but it's tough to, that room is just, it echoes, and it's just, you know.
No, but as long as we've got him here, see.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Brian.
Mr. Bean.
This is good.
Mr. Waddell?
Sounds good to me.
So do we need a motion?
I'll make a motion that we accept the what is it?
$8,322
for the new equipment and the new studio down there.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. We appreciate.
There's only one more thing.
One more thing you
the
got
other
going
thing
there.
Is the total info package. It's a yearly thing. We've been doing it for the last 5 years. It's the it gives you the weather along with the bulletin board. It gives you the weather up to date. News and sports and all that that plays along with the and it's $983 for the year.
$983.
$983.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second it.
$983 for the
all those
sports.
In favor? Unanimous. I think that it's a good.
I like it. Yeah, I think it's
something good. It adds.
Right, it does. It adds to it.
Compliments everything you do there. Thank you very much. We appreciate
Brian,
it.
Really quickly, if we want to get a DVD of a meeting, is it still $10 per DVD?
$10.
And we can talk to you.
Well, you talk to Christina, and then she talks to us.
Super.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Mr. Welch, Town Manager's Report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, pursuant to an instruction from the board, I've issued each member of the board, as well as the Cable Committee, the Assistant Town Manager, and Town Council, a copy of the current cable contract for review, and have requested suggestions on possible amendments for the cable renewal process. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hopefully that will get started. I haven't been contacted by the company yet, but they said they were going to contact me.
Yeah.
I've been notified that the police department will be conducting night firing exercises and training during this week. Mm-hmm. So if you hear sudden noises, that may be them. The State Office of Emergency Management has announced an award of $44,119 to Hampton for payment and support of the radiological emergency plan training during the state fiscal year. The Southeast Regional Refuse Disposal Committee, our district, has offered to receive residents from Hampton at their household hazardous waste collection in Brentwood with selectman permission and payment by the town. And I'll make the comment that the payment is $50 a car, and it is recommended that we not participate due to the fact we have no funding for that. The assessing department, as you heard Ed report a few minutes ago, reported a taxable valuation increase of $8,267,700 over 2014, which will help us with our tax rate a little bit. The state DRA has notified us that they are working on assuring that state aid to cities and towns will be for the full budget year. Those amounts are currently targeted for half of the year due to the six-month budget continuing resolution. Without further action by the state, and I'm told they're going to take that action, our state aid would be reduced by 50% against the tax rate. That would be a substantial increase. I've ordered a curtailment on expenditures from the budget due to the year-end estimates of remaining funds. The curtailment does not affect personal services or warrant articles. With the board's permission, I'm looking to schedule a town auction for surplus materials in the month of October. We may be back to the board for permission to sell scrap metals directly to a dealer in order to receive higher income. Mm. We'll have to see how much we have and see whether or not that pays us to do it. I'm currently projecting that my review of the budget will be completed by September 11th. Huh. That's it, Mr. Chairman.
Did someone tell us to shut the air conditioner off?
What?
It's all of a sudden it got really hot in here.
Oh.
No. It was cold when we got here.
It's not warm.
That's because we're full of hot air.
I'm not going there either.
Somewhere. Mr. Bridle.
The only question I had for the town manager was the property on Pearl Street. Where are we at with that?
We have to give 90 days written notice. We have given that notice. We'll be preparing the bid shortly. Not bids, but the auction sequence and materials. They have 30 days in which to respond. We're waiting for that 30 days to expire,
okay.
And then we'll move forward.
had a question on that the other day. That's what I figured I'd ask.
It's a good question.
Questions for the town manager's report.
Ah, Fred. I did see a bid from the rec department for vinyl siding, but it specifies a specific type of siding in the bid. Is that appropriate? Wouldn't that tend to...
It has to match the existing siding on the building that they're replacing.
Okay.
So.
Okay. That sounds sensible. The parking stalls letter that we got from the LaCourses.
Okay, are these things on the town manager's report? I'm trying to stick to that.
Well, the town manager is the one
who handles...
We have
old business coming up next.
All right. Thank you. Let's see. I'll ask you under the...
Mr. Bean.
Negative, sir.
Mr. Waddell.
Yes. You voted a curtailment of expenditures from the budget due to year-end estimates. How much of a problem is that going to be? How much of a problem is that going to be for departments?
It's going to be a problem. I mean, anytime you have to start curtailing expenses, you have to start planning your budget more timely. The last finance report that we had that we gave to the board gave an estimate of having a year-end closing balance of $12,500 or thereabouts on a $26 million budget. That's a little close. I want to take a look at the September, the August finals in mm-hmm. September to see where we are. We have been very frugal in expending, and the more frugal we are, the further into the year we go, the better off we're going to be. We have a forecast for bad snow starting in October. We haven't had snow starting in October for 3 years, and we certainly haven't had bad snow in the first half of the winter for 3 years. So we're being cautious because we know we have to have those funds available to do the work.
Okay, and you'll keep us up to date on that? And
if there's a problem, you'll certainly know it.
Okay. Thank you.
Could I do a quick follow-up on that? Where does it show the 12,000, Fred? Because I've got my July expense statement.
If you look in the front.
Yeah.
I have to find it, too.
Because I didn't notice that. I think my radar would have gone up if I noticed it. So obviously I was...
Bullet number two, expense summary.
Yeah. Without debt service.
We're 58.28%
of the budget,
which is under this month's target of by $12,400.
Okay, then I didn't read that right, I guess.
Yeah, that's, and I asked Christy about that, and it's close. It's very close.
Because
that would be based strictly on percentages, which is probably a bad thing to base it on, but it's the only measurement we have at this time of the year.
Because when I looked back at last year, and we, this year, the budget for 2015 is 5,238,317 for the Public Works Department, and 2014 was 5,060,215.
Well, I'm looking at the bottom line of the entire town.
Okay. Well, we had 178,102 more this year just in the appropriation, unless I'm reading that wrong.
We spent $300,000 more than we had in the appropriation for snow removal.
Okay.
So we're trying to catch up with that extra money that we had to spend. And we're doing it at this point. We're almost level.
Because something that concerns me, and I think I mentioned this to you in passing, and something that concerns me with the Public Works budget, is that for years we're not doing, the budget committee looks at the 26,000 for sidewalks and they say, you haven't done anything. Well, no, we haven't. Because we don't have the crews, we don't have the manpower, and we are not getting things done. The non-utility trees aren't being trimmed. The normal summer things that we used to have highway crews going around doing haven't been done for the past several years that I can recall. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering when we get to our budget discussions where all this is going to fit in.
The reason you're having these problems is because you're lumping the entire Public Works budget into one total.
Right.
The statute doesn't do that. The accounting is incorrect.
Ah.
For instance, you have a number of accounts in Public Works.
Yep.
But you'll notice that they're all totaled to the bottom of the Public Works Department. Mm-hmm. That's not the way the state has them under administrative regulation. Each one of those separate sections is totaled separately.
Why are we doing that?
I have no idea. Oh. I've complained about it before, but that's the way we're doing it. So I'm going to attempt to change that this year because snow comes under the same account as paving,
mm-hmm.
road maintenance,
mm-hmm.
but it doesn't have the sewer department, and it doesn't have solid waste in it. Our budget does.
Well, that's why I'm considering, just from my perspective, trying to understand if we need a better allocation of our DPW resources so that we can get more of the things done that we would hope to have done.
Well, what we need to structure them the way the state has their accounting system structured, which says the town is supposed to do certain things with that accounting.
Right.
And certain things are supposed to be in different departments.
Right.
Okay. That's not the way we have it structured. So if you have a $300,000 overrun in snow.
Right.
That could come out of solid waste, or it could
right.
come out of the sewer department. No, wrong.
Okay.
It can't. That's okay. not the way the accounting system is set up by the state, but that's the way the town has the accounting system
set up.
So
what you'll be presenting to us for 2016, you think, will be?
I'm gonna total those individual state account line items by line item.
Okay. That's going to be
interesting. Instead of totaling the whole Public Works budget in total.
Oh. It may clarify.
We'll give you a figure for the whole thing, but that's...
That may clarify... the total better. It may clarify the function.
Well, it'll isolate the sums, so we're not taking okay. something from snow and using paving
okay.
to offset that.
Okay. And I will get the information for you that was provided to me on the snow insurance. Whether that would do
well,
us any
fine.
Good as a town, I don't know.
I don't know either.
We'll try it.
Thank
try
you
it.
For your report,
Thank
Mr.
you, sir.
Welch. Moving on to old business. Do you want to join us up at the table, Jay?
Sure.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. And we discussed this earlier, and pretty much we're just, does someone want to make a motion?
Well, I want to discuss first. Let me know.
Well,
when you're
I thought
ready.
We would bring up where Jay is here right now.
Yes.
That's the only thing we have.
I'm
so
prepared
what would you like to discuss?
To discuss this. Jay, you were in 2 weeks ago
mm-hmm.
and asking for a pay raise for the conservation coordinator, which is your right to do
mm-hmm.
as the chairman of the Conservation Commission. Somehow other positions got pulled in, and that is not appropriate. But addressing your situation alone, I agree with you that, with your recommendation as chairman of the Conservation Commission, that it would be appropriate for you to propose a pay raise for the conservation coordinator, but only at this year's percent, which is 1.5%, which is what was granted to the other non-union employees, and only from the date that you requested it, which was 2 weeks ago, whatever date that was. Well, whatever it was 2 weeks ago, what, the 10th or something like
12.
That. So I would be prepared, but I don't have a figure. So I don't know what the figure would be. I am totally opposed to backdating, particularly in prior years. I don't think it's a fair thing to do to backtrack. Now, in the future, you may want to. Whoever's going to be heading the Conservation Commission, they need to understand that the non-union raises ideally would start April 1st in any given year. But I don't have a dollar amount to move here. Well, I guess we could use the proposed hourly rate. From August 10th, is that the last? Where the heck is the calendar? Yeah. So from August 10th on, I will propose, let's see, and you're asking for $19.10 per hour. But is that, does that incorporate the 3%? Because I don't want the 3%. I don't want to go back into a prior year, let alone earlier this year. So if you can get us a correct figure. If that's not the correct figure, then I will hold, and when we meet next week, I'll be happy to make the motion.
Does someone else have another motion?
Just to refresh our memory.
Sure.
When was the last time they had a raise in that office?
2013.
Summer of 2013.
So 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
And you're asking now for a 3% raise from starting now?
I'm asking for 3% starting now, which would be 1.5% for 2014 and 1.5% for 2015.
Yeah.
I don't want to cloud the issue.
Yes, I'm asking for
3% starting now.
Correct.
Moving forward.
Correct.
But that 3% would incorporate the theoretical 2014 1.5% raise, and I'm not going
yes,
there.
Yes, however, you're having no raise in 2014.
Irrelevant. That's gone.
Well, you're right. And there won't be any back pay for that. But moving forward.
1.5%.
You're right in that I'm not asking for back pay. I'm not asking to make up for the increase that the coordinator might have gotten for 2014 from that period till now.
And why wasn't there an, why wasn't, and I'm doing this for the public more than anything else, why wasn't there a raise in 2014?
Because the budget wasn't passed.
Budget wasn't passed. Mm-hmm. Was it in the budget?
Mm-hmm.
I believe so.
It was.
So you can't go there.
This is why I'm bringing this up. So, I just brought that up for conversation, so.
So, other comments? Mr. Wardell?
No, I don't have any.
Mr. Bean?
And so, when we last visited this was a 1.5% pay raise, correct?
No, it was 3%.
3%? And what's the total for the year, for the rest of the year, the dollar figure?
For the rest of the year, it would be $292.32.
3%. Forget whatever year it is. Going forward now, this 3% is for the rest of this fiscal year.
Correct.
Is how much?
$292.32.
Thank you very much.
And you have that in your budget?
Yes, we do.
But does that have anything to do with the other people only got a point and a half from the other?
It's irrelevant whether people asked for a pay raise last year. That's done. I'm not backing into a prior year. And we had a problem when we set up our new policy last year. We didn't want to see any backtracking till January 1st, because that had happened a couple of times in prior years. We agreed to dovetail to April 1st, or afterward, if it's a situation where you don't want to give somebody a raise till October, in a case like this. But for generic, non-union town employees, April 1st is the cutoff date. And I am not backing into a prior calendar year. And I'm not backing up in this year either, because the conservation chairman's request came in to us at August 10th. And I'm fine with accommodating his request. It's perfectly legitimate. The individual is a non-union employee employed by the Conservation Commission, so that's fine. But I'm only willing to grant 1.5% from August 10th on if we choose as a board to validate that. What happened last year is gone.
I'd like to just say, though, that Jay was instructed to wait, and we would take this into consideration, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
By whom?
By a lot of people.
No. I don't care about a lot of people. The decision is in our lap.
Okay. Well,
I didn't vote last year anything about we'll fix it next year for you. No. You want to find it in the minutes for me, fine. But I'm not going to back into a prior year. I think it's absolutely improper.
Is there a motion on the floor?
Well, I don't have a motion until I would have an adjusted figure.
So, you know, I personally, I feel that I don't see why it should be more than what the other people that are, I mean, we started this conversation about being the similar to the other employees, which they got 1.5%. That's how I feel about it.
Did they not also get 1.5% last year?
Yes, it was requested. But your employee is different, Jay. She works for you, not for us.
She's a part-time employee?
Yes.
Does not get health insurance?
Correct.
I move that pay be raised 3% for the balance of the year, effective 10 August.
It's not the balance of the year. It's going to go into next year.
I have a motion.
I'll second.
Any further discussion?
Bad, bad, bad.
All those in favor? Against?
I'm opposed. For the reason that I stipulated.
Thank you, gentlemen. May I make one additional comment? Just for information purposes for going forward. We can come to you in April, if the budget has not passed, to make the same request. But we need to then make sure that we have extra money in our budget that's going to cover that increase for the balance of the year that hasn't been approved in the budget. I don't think it's fair to the town that we be in that position or that we put the town in that position every year.
Can we deal with next year? Next year,
you got it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Okay, and let's see here. Does there? I feel that really that's all we have to discuss. Does anyone else have anything that they want to talk about this?
I do.
Okay.
I just want to mention that pursuant to our discussion 2 weeks ago. It is totally inappropriate for us
to... Okay, we understand that.
Well, apparently it wasn't understood, and I want to reiterate, Rusty is interested in making sure the public understands where we're coming from. It is totally inappropriate for this board to address the salary of the tax collector or the town clerk at all. That's between themselves,
we're
the
not
budget
discussing
committee,
it.
And the voters. Well, you have it on the agenda.
Okay, well, it was
and
brought...
And we talked about it last week.
It was brought up to...
Yes.
There was a misunderstanding here. I was under the impression from what I heard here 2 weeks ago that there were other employees. That's why I asked that it would go back
into private. And I stipulated very clearly
okay, well, I'm not
ago,
sure you're always right. Those, in fact, I've not seen many times when you weren't.
Those positions are off the table.
Okay, well, we understand that. That's
well,
not
I'm
what
glad.
The discussion's about. The discussion for me to ask it to go back was because I understood that there were other employees that weren't elected officials. So that's been cleared up.
And the town
up.
Clerk, the tax collector,
okay,
and the
we understand,
were
Mary
specifically
Louise.
Mentioned. So I just want to clarify
okay,
for the
we
public.
Understand.
Yep.
You're not the only one that understands.
No.
But you quite often think you are the only one, so that's another issue. Any other old business?
Do you want to bring up rooms and meals tax under old business?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Well, I went to the State House last week and attended
right.
a organizational meeting for the committee that is studying the rooms and meals tax for the state, studying coming up with a new formula for the rooms and meals tax. And Senator Stiles was elected the chairperson, which is good for us. Representative Emmerich was up there at the meeting also. He's not on the committee, but he was there. And they're doing a lot of work on this. And I think it's important for us as selectmen.
Rusty, what did you have for dinner?
It's important for us for selectmen to come up with as much information as we can to bring to that committee that will help them to come up with a new formula. I think it's also important for us to realize, which is hard to realize sometimes, that we have to that there are 400 members up there. And if we end up and no member is going to vote for their town to get less money.
Right.
Which is important.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to come up with a formula that will be, you know, equitable to Hampton, and that's what they're going to work on. And we have to come up with the facts and the figures to bring up there to them to have them, you know, have a good understanding of what goes on. Now, I've already talked with the town manager, and I'll talk with the police chief and the fire chief. And I've talked with the director of public works to get these figures together and to get, you know, how the summer is different than the rest of the season on the rooms and meals tax. I think, you know, all of our state reps are behind us. They're all working on this. I think it's something that probably she can come up, that the committee can come up with a new formula.
but I think it's important for us to work closely and not take a, well, they just should do it attitude, because that's not going to happen. You know, we're going to have to grease the works up there. We're going to have to go up there. We're going to have to talk to people. We're going to have to talk to other representatives. We're going to have to work to get it done. So I think that's important. We have another meeting on the 27th. I have volunteered that I will go to all the meetings. I will bring all the information back to you. I'll bring the information from us up to them and try and get it done. You know, one thing that comes up always with the state reps, the other state reps, is you have a very large tax base that other towns don't have. So, you know, you're already getting a lot of taxes. But that's irrelevant to the argument, and we just got to present that in a manner that it's irrelevant. So we got a lot of work to do on it. But I think it's a start, and I think that if we support Senator Stiles, we support our representatives in getting this done, that maybe they can come up with something next year in a positive manner.
And how much time do you know in advance of when there is going to be?
They publish it in the calendar, the State House calendar, and they have the next two meetings already scheduled. So I can send you, the next one's the 27th, I believe, and then I can send you when the next one is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Any other old business that you have?
Not that I have.
No. Mr. Bridle? Mrs. Wolseley?
Alrighty. Fred, the grist mill, where are we? As you said, I think there was going to be an RFP because there are no plans for the grist mill, even though the article passed. Can you update us on what's happening?
The grist mill or the dam?
I'm sorry, the grist mill dam. I apologize.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're only capable of working on one dam at a time, and that's a DAM.
Wow.
And we're finishing up the one for
you're doing the ice pond?
The ice pond. That's one that was furthest along.
Right.
The dam itself at the grist mill is going to have to start from scratch.
Right.
And that's something that as soon as we can get the other one done, we're going to jump right into that. We're
about
all prepared
the RFP?
To go. Well, I'm not sure an RFP, but we do need a request for engineering services.
Right. Okay.
So I don't want to have to do this twice, an RFP and be an RFQ and a bid.
Okay.
I think we're going to go right straight to the bid.
Okay.
Try to cut chase and cut our time and do our management better on that.
Okay.
But that's going to be a little while down the road.
Okay. Mr. LaCourse and the parking stalls, and I don't know if that's something we're allowed to do or what, but he did send us that letter asking about setting up parking stalls or whatever. We
have parking stalls on a number of streets in town.
Okay.
One of the things we're going to try to do is get the ones at the beach, the main beach, in fact painted so that we have some regulation there.
Okay.
Because we have people jockeying for position trying to block driveways and park in front of fire hydrants.
Yeah.
All kinds of a double park, and we've had situations where abutters are paving over the sidewalks, they can park on that. It's not a good situation, so we need to straighten it out so we have some consistency in what's going on. And we can then regulate the parking and get it in such a way as we can get police and fire access in there.
Okay. Now, can you tell us whether the individuals for parking enforcement have been hired yet? As last I knew, the chief said they just have the supervisor.
They just have the supervisor currently.
So basically, we're not going to be doing parking enforcement until next year.
We don't have the people on hand at the moment. At least I have not been told we have the people on hand at the moment.
I will say,
the chief's jurisdiction.
It's kind of disappointing because I started talking about this last November, and here we've gone through a whole summer without enhanced parking enforcement. Place Cove, I know that you had complaints that the stairs were dislodged and it was hard for people to get up the granite blocks that form the stairs to get down there. There appears to be no handicapped access to Place Cove at this point in time. Is there a possibility of putting, I think there used to be a ramp there, putting a ramp there, putting a ramp over the stairs, so you wouldn't even have to walk downstairs. Everybody could access via a ramp. There are people who are frustrated about not being able to access that beach, and it is a public beach.
Yeah, well, we've asked the state, and the answer is no. They're not going to issue a permit to allow us to do anything.
So that would be a state.
The state would have to issue a wetlands permit for us to do that, and they've said they will not issue a permit for us to be done.
Yeah, and the ramps that were done in the past, I think they were done privately, with private money.
Even though that's our beach.
Well, it comes under state authority, and I can't. Although I want to build the ramp.
Yeah.
The answer has been unequivocally no. They will not issue a permit for that work.
Well, it's not surprising, I might say, given the degree of cooperation. And I hope when we come to the next joint operation plan negotiations that some of us keep in mind what the state will not do and help us to get rid of their trash so they can put dumpsters.
I don't want to blame DRED for this because it has nothing to do with DRED.
Well, the state is the state.
How do they get around that on ADA?
That was a question that was asked.
I have no idea. All that I know is that I need a permit to construct anything down there, and I can't get one.
Yeah, so.
Interesting.
So, because it's in a wetland.
Yeah, somebody should look into that.
Yeah, for all the good it will do you, bless your heart.
It's like being in a rotary with no exit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the goals printout, which people had been asking for, was put on the website.
Yep.
By courtesy of Assistant Town Manager Sullivan, and that went up, I believe, a week ago.
Yes.
So the public can look at that. And I am going to ask us to revisit the goals because I think we need to refine. I've been asking for us to meet with selectmen appointed committees. Once we have the flyer or the sheet or broadside or whatever it is, explaining to them their duties. And it is now 8 months on into the year, and I'm still kind of waiting for that so we can schedule at least one representative from every selectman committee so they have some guidelines as to what they need to be doing, posting of minutes, posting of agendas, etc. Do we have any hope?
I could stop doing the budget so I can do it.
Oh, we don't want you to stop doing the budget.
But I haven't had the time. That's been part of the problem.
Okay. I appreciate that. Thank you, Fred.
Mr. Bean. No. We covered you. Next, we move on to new business. Harris Ave petition for leasing of parking spaces on a public road.
What happened to number two?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I need an explanation on that one.
Well, we're going to go on that. We'll finish that. But let's, since I already mentioned about Harris, let's just go with that right now. Were they people going to come from the beach?
That I do not know, sir. We received a petition.
We have it. Yeah.
From the residents of Harris Avenue, requesting that, in fact, the selectmen lease.
Is this the petition? Let me read it.
Yes, it is.
On petition by Eileen DeBoole, the undersigned property owners of Harris Ave, Hampton Beach, New Hampshire, request the Town of Hampton Board of Selectmen to allow the property owners of Harris Ave to apply for and obtain one lease parking space in front of their property only from May 21st to September 21st for a reasonable fee to be determined by the town and the agreed upon by the property owners. A placard will be issued to the property owner noting the lease space either by number and or street address to be prominently displayed on the dashboard of the vehicles parked in the designated space. The property owner will have full authority to have violators towed at the violator's expense. Written documentation of this permitted space will be provided to each property owner at the time of permit issuance. Appropriate signage will be posted at both signs of Harris Ave by the Town of Hampton. The placard may be renewed yearly subject to Board of Selectmen approval. I just want to say that I've talked to both of these women that, you know, were circulating this, and I suggested that they need to have the police chief of police on board for this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, where do you stand on it, Mr. Welch?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think their frustration comes from the fact that they can't use the parking in front of their houses because mm-hmm. it's taken up by other people. I did have the fire chief go down, or the deputy fire chief go down and take a look at the individual properties on Harris Avenue.
Yeah.
And there were cars parked on both sides of the street. There's not a problem getting fire engines through. It's probably one of the widest streets of the beach. I also asked to have the aerial photographs prepared, which I've given to each of you, mm-hmm. Of the properties on Harris Avenue. I wish the rest of the beach had parking that was this good on the individual properties. Mm-hmm. Because some of these parking spaces look like they have space for up to five or six cars on a particular lot. Frankly, I don't see the need. And if you do wish to do it, you can. You have to go through the 4114A process, which will take about a month and a half.
And what does that mean?
That means you'll have to hold at least three public hearings.
Yeah.
And I would suggest to you that if you do that, you could. They'd have to pay for all the signs and have them erected at our expense. They'd have to pay for that. They'd also have to pay taxes on each of the lots, each of the parking spaces, because the law requires them to do that. And you'd have to do that every year, because this would be a one-year lease. You'd have to repeat this. One of my fears is that everybody else at the beach is going to make the same request. Mm-hmm. You're going to have no parking.
They have suggested this would be like a pilot year, you know, to try it. But what would you? How would a price be determined if something like this was to go forward?
Well, it would have to be. There would have to be an assessed value from the assessing department placed in each parking space. Mm-hmm. Because it's an assessment. It's an assessment of property taxes.
Yeah.
That will be assessed against each of these parking spaces. And you know how...
Would it be the same as the assessment on their land for their home?
Well, it would be based on the same factors. So the cost would be rather high, I'm sure. The state does lease spaces on their property. I don't know how they calculate that. But
they calculate it by according to whatever that space brought the year before.
Okay.
That's what they get. Okay. Exactly.
That's not what the law provides for towns. The mm-hmm. state can do whatever they want. We have to assess it as if it's real property. So you would be paying a property tax on it. You get a bill for it. You know how scarce parking is at the beach?
Yeah.
So the cost per space, I would assume, would be very high.
Mm-hmm.
It could be very high. I just don't know. But that would be up to the assessor to determine.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's a good example to set, because then you'll have to face every other street in town the same way. If there were no parking on the individual lots down there, and that's not what the aerial photographs show, every property down there has adequate parking on their property, unless you have 10 or 12 cars per house. Mm. It doesn't make a lot of sense to do something like this.
And
I suppose if you don't want anybody parking on the street, you could make it no parking the entire street.
And has the police chief weighed in on this?
He hasn't as of yet.
No. Okay, Mr. Bridle.
The fire chief looked at it, or the deputy fire chief looked at it, and there was not a problem with the parking there is right now.
Right.
And this is a public street, not a private street.
Right.
I think it's a slippery slope we're headed down if we even start to entertain this. I think you're going to have this happening through the whole beach. I think it's going to be a difficult task to do to even get to that process. And I'd be willing to make a motion to deny the request if anybody else wants to.
Okay, let's let everyone have their say.
That's fine.
Why don't we start with you?
Thank you. I think it's a slippery slope, but what I'm thinking here is what a revenue it would be. Even if everybody did it, if everybody was leasing it, we were taxing all those properties, I mean, we'd have a lot of money coming in.
Uh-oh. Is that something you want to explore?
No, I don't. But I'm just saying that it would be it's a source of revenue that, but, you know, I was reading an article last week where some cities, you know, parking spaces can go up to $1 million for parking space.
That's true.
Yeah, you know.
You have to realize, though, that if this spreads, you do it through the whole beach.
Then nobody else would be able to come, yeah.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'll have nobody coming to the beach except on state parking.
Yeah. No, I'm just...
Well, 2 weeks ago, a week ago Sunday, they were getting $50 a space at one of the lots.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of hefty. Mm-hmm. $50 a space per day.
And per day.
That's a hefty.
And I think 40 is pretty regular. Although, with the big event yesterday, it was a washout. there was, I think parking was $5 in many spots. And they still didn't come.
Yeah.
Mrs. Woolsey, you're always trying to raise new money.
I agree with Rusty. It's a slippery slope. I don't know that we have a necessity to respond by a vote. I think we just respond that it's not an appropriate thing to do at this time. So I'm not prepared to vote on it, but I agree with you. I don't think we should touch it.
And Mr. Bean?
Yes. It is Hampton. It is Hampton Beach. They're one and the same. And traffic, parking, those challenges extend right up here. During the school year, and many of us are not untouched by thousands and thousands of cars all year round going by our properties. Municipal response vehicles, weddings, church use, public gathering events, the exodus from the beach with traffic on Winnicott Road. And so that's kind of the pleasure of living in this town, and it's wonderful that people come here, and if we start blocking off more and more of it, we'll just bottleneck it and it will become someone else's parking problem. Yeah. And I'm opposed to that, and I'm happy people that do want to come here and enjoy themselves. It's a short season. The older we get, the less we seem to enjoy it sometimes, but it is nice that people do come here. Mr. Welch and his staff did do a good job of bringing it up on the satellite, taking a look at property. They did research taxpayer, property owner, parking availability. While it's never a perfect solution, he did staff it, and I'm satisfied with his research and see no reason to act now. Thank you.
So did you still want to make your motion?
I think it's pretty clear. We're all set.
Okay. So will somebody get back to them, or?
I'll be happy to write them a note. Sure. Yeah, okay. Absolutely, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you. And let's see. The next non-town of Hampton, wait a minute. Yeah. Non-town of Hampton government utilization of Hampton Trust Funds.
Chairman, I ask that be put on the agenda. And we've had initial discussions. This is not for a motion. This is simply laying a foundation for a concept that many in town might not be adverse to. And of course, the selectmen are in charge of the prudential affairs of the town of Hampton. The Board of Trustees were kind enough to come in last couple of weeks, and go over their very challenging responsibilities of managing close to $20 million of taxpayer money. Today, the market's opened up, and it is quite a bloodbath. Mm-hmm. It's a bloodbath in emerging markets. It's a bloodbath in Germany. It's a bloodbath in Europe. It's a bloodbath in Russia. It's a bloodbath everywhere. And there are uncontrollable events that we cannot control, that the people on Wall Street cannot control. They don't know how to handle this. We have communist governments devaluing their currency. We have communist governments mandating people invest. And we, last quarter, lost $167,000 in the market, as we were briefed by the Board of Trustees. And that does not include today, and I hate to think how much money we lost today out of that that equity money that the town of Hampton has. And if we lost $167,000 last quarter, that, of course, was enough to pay for the motion we just made for the Toll Farm Road project. We have lost millions of dollars in the past in that fund. The data was here. I won't bore the board, the town manager, or the folks on that again, but we have researched the data and it's come through. There is a concept of what is actually done with that money. And if you do the drill down from the data, the account custody statements that the Board of Trustees so nicely provided us. When you look at these, you'll go to the portfolio detail, and you can go to something as simple as the Normandy Park, Washington Fund that our money is in. And so you say to yourself, we have to spend our own money. If we want to use our money in accordance with current state law, we have to pay an interest fee, 3 or 4%. So other towns, other municipalities are using our money. For example, from the account custody statement, we look at the Normandy Park, Washington Redevelopment Authority. And it's the Redevelopment Authority of Montgomery County. And there's actually Normandy Park, and it's in Washington. This area is the 26th in per capita income out of 522 areas in the state of Washington. And they are using our money, and they're paying us 3.9%. So they are using Town of Hampton tax money. We're getting a simple 3%, and if we want to use our own money, we have to pay 3 or 4% and pay that back. So other people in other towns that are in the top 2 or 3% within the state of Washington are using Hampton taxpayer money, and we, of course, have to pay the same premium that they do. And to me, as a graduate of Hampton Academy, Winnicott High School, and the Whittemore School at the University of New Hampshire, that doesn't make much sense. And as you go on, you can look at the Redevelopment Authority of Montgomery County. They are paying us 3.79%. They use it for association housing. They use it to redevelop their own county. Again, you have people that are in no way related, no way connected to us, but they are using Town of Hampton taxpayer money to develop their lives in a better fashion for the same price we are. If you continue the drill down, you look at the Missouri State Development Finance Board infrastructure. They have appropriations for their water systems. They have appropriations for improvement projects. Down at Branson Landing, Branson, Missouri, they've got gambling, and it's quite a town. And they're using our money. And the folks down in Missouri, they're paying us 4% and change. So again, people are having a good time with our money, but under the current state law, and the way our fund is structured, we can't use it unless we pay the same amount of money they do. Going on, you have the Maryland Health and Higher Education, and this will be the last one. We've been in meetings for 3 hours. I don't want to bore anybody. And we're not looking for a motion or change anyone's idea, but this is just information that I don't think I knew. I know I didn't know this until I started looking at it. We provided this information by the Board of Trustees. And I know the public doesn't know. And it's an interesting perspective. The Maryland Health and Higher Education Facilities Authority, this is down in Maryland. It assists hospitals, which are doing quite well. They make a lot of money, and even the nonprofits. And people are paid very well at some of these nonprofits, and they make substantial salaries. Site acquisition, educational institutions, construction, capital equipment. And the authority is funded from interest earnings on investments and fees charged to participating borrowers. So they're taking our money, they're lending out our money, they're making a profit on our money, but we can't use our own money. And to me, that's odd. And when we hear of firefighters not getting a pay raise in the last budget negotiations, when we hear about the exigent demands of basically operating on ether because of this storm, we hear Selectman Wolseley rightly looking at weather insurance to mitigate this unforeseen ability to forecast the budget. We see where we pursue, and the Selectman almost unanimously would like to draw down some funds, and the state intercedes in our business and tells us we can't do it, a bureaucrat. Going forward into the next year, for the Warren article, and town council has provided this, he provided this last year, the Warren article would state that the amount of money borrowed should be paid back to the real estate fund without interest. So we could take our money, our $19 million, and we could do infrastructure projects. We can benefit Hampton people, and we can pay the money back. And I don't know what we lost today, if we lost anything. I would imagine we lost quite a bit of money today. Last quarter, we lost $167,000, and the performance of the market was nothing like it is today. And I'll be getting with the town manager and finance, and through you, Mr. Chairman, to see exactly what that state of affairs looks like. Again, the selectmen are in charge of the prudential affairs of this town. The trustees, of course, have their statutory responsibilities, and they're an integrity-based group of people, and they were nice to come in here. However, I think that the management of this money should come under very close scrutiny. The maintenance of this money and how it is used for the benefit of the people that own it, which is the Hampton people, should be explored in a new light, especially in this environment. Back in 2008, we lost millions and millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. And if you extrapolate that investment objective of 3%, that's $60,000 a year for the last 7 years. That's another Exeter Road we could have done. The 167, as we saw tonight, we voted to take that in a tight budget and improve Toll Farm Road. So again, we've been in a meeting for now 3 hours, the board has, but I think in line with the prudential affairs that we look and with today's bloodbath on Wall Street and protect our interests and use our own money instead of other people throughout the country, some of whom that are very much well better off than we are, and we use it for ourselves. Thank you very much.
So you're in favor of that warrant article that you just mentioned?
Yes, and that was drafted last year. And how it is read now is that we have to pay the 3%, and it's set by the trustees, and it's market rates. And we would simply be able to use our own money and pay it back, the principal only. And we work out a repayment detail on that. And we take an asset that isn't going to be evaporated like the last quarter of $167,000 or God knows what we lost today, and we actually get something out of it. Thank you.
Mr. Wardell.
I would just like to respond. I mean, I can understand Selectman Bean's fears of the market and stuff, but markets go up and markets go down. And as the Board of Trustees, the trustees of the trust explained to us the last time, this is 100-year money. It's not short-term money. It's not money that a retiree might have to be taking out right now to live on. And I think that I feel they're doing a good job in managing the money. I think it's something, it's like an IRA that you don't really want to take your principal out of because it's generating money for you. It's generating about $600,000 in income for us. And, the way that the real estate trust was set up initially, you would have to change that dramatically, I think, in order to do that. You're always going to invest in bonds, states, or companies that are doing well because those are the companies that are going to continue to do well. So it's going to be a safer investment than investing in somebody that's not doing well. I'm comfortable with the way the money is being done right now, and I would be uncomfortable in taking money out of the principal. And I think it is serving the people of Hampton. And I don't think money like that, and I think the trustees of the trust explained last week that you can't look at that on a month-to-month or a year-to-year basis. I mean, overall, since they've been doing it, it's grown. I mean, I think we saw that it's grown overall. I mean, 1 year you might have a loss in certain parts, but what has it done over the life of the trust? That's the important thing, and what's it going to continue to do? So I think it puts us in a very, very good position, financial position, and I think it needs to continue to generate income. And I think that's what it was set up for, and I think that's the important part of it.
Mr. Bridle.
I think Hampton's in a unique situation here because there aren't many towns that got a $20 million nest egg. I probably dare say if there are a handful of them in the state of New Hampshire that have it, I'd be surprised. I appreciate all the work Mr. Bean has done on this, and I think there is some use of that money that we may want to possibly look at. I'm a little hesitant to pull all of our fund out of there, but I think we still should look at it down the road and not take anything off the table of what to do for the betterment of this community. And the market is very volatile right now. And what it's going to do over the next year or two, I couldn't tell you. I'd be surprised to see who could tell you. It's a scary situation out there right now with the market the way it is. And I'm glad he's at least brought this forward. I don't know if we should be doing a warrant article this year or not, but I think it's worth more discussion. So.
Yeah, the things do change all the time. The one thing that we have to look forward to is the price of oil. It seems to be really low. Mrs. Woolsey.
No, I agree with Mr. Waddell.
Okay. Is that all you have to say?
That's it.
Yeah. And I'd be in favor of putting a warrant article out, maybe as an advisory warrant article, to see how the people out there feel about it.
Well, you know, we brought up 79E a couple of years ago. Luxury housing got $175,000, $150,000 of tax write-offs. Mary Louise supported that. It was I won't characterize it how I feel about it, but it was luxury housing that went for over $400 a square foot. It was a state law. It was had the genesis with local legislators. It's never been used again, and Mary Louise supported that. We don't all see eye to eye on every issue. I would say, however, that I think these times are extraordinary. The bond market, treasuries, nobody called this a month ago, or the money wouldn't be there. Nobody could have called with any fortitude the lack of fundamentals that exist in the market today, how we are relying on a communist regime in China that suddenly devalues its currency, that orders its people to invest in the stock market. That's where our nest egg is. And I am not talking about spending the money. I'm talking about simply taking an asset, using it for our own benefit, and putting the money back. I think if you're gambling, whether it's down at Hampton Beach, or if you're gambling with a lottery ticket, or you're in Vegas and you've made one heck of a lot of money, I think sometimes the smart investor and the smart gambler takes his money off the table for a while and puts it back in his own pocket. And then when the fools have all rushed in and lost a lot of theirs, like people did today, then they go back in, and I think that's where the smart money is. And nobody's talking about spending the money. We're talking about using our own money for our own benefit and putting it back in. But we'll have that debate, and certainly that's just my perspective, and it may make sense. And like 79E, that was defeated at the polls, but it hasn't been used again. So I think that was an effective piece of work that Mary Louise and I worked together on and supported and thought the same way. But I think given what's gone on today, and I do want to find out how our $19 million fared this week, this quarter, and hopefully it's not bad. But if we lost $167,000 last quarter, 100-year money, no one here is going to be around here in 30 years sitting at this board. I'm interested in today's money. And that's taxpayer money, and I think in a civil way we bring that forward. We get some projects that Public Works, we get some projects that our town needs identified, and we actually look at that, and then we can have a more intelligent discussion. Thank you very much.
And you've started a potential list of warrant articles?
Well,
I have approximately 50 of them, but just two of those, or actually three of those, that need to be done relatively soon, top $2 million right off the top.
This is on the goals list. This is stipulated on the goals list, number six or something like that has been on our list.
I'm just taking a look at things that we need to do in the really near future. Mm-hmm. The seawall at Bicentennial Park, that's over $1 million to replace that wall. The septage receiving station at the wastewater treatment facility, which would include a washdown facility, is over $1 million. The High Street culvert, which needs to be desperately replaced, whether we do the dam or not, it's immaterial. that's going to be $500,000.
Right.
Those are just three projects that we have to do in the next year or two, or there's going to be some serious problems, and we don't need any of those problems. It will cost us even more money. That's just the tip of the iceberg. Mm-hmm. We start looking at streets, we start looking at sewers, we're looking at lining sewers instead of digging them up, because that may be the most effective way, but we can't do that with all the sewers. Some of them are broken, and we have to dig them up.
Yeah. You're going to need enhanced generator capacity at the wastewater treatment plant.
It just goes on and on and on.
It sounds like that, you know, that maybe we can bring this up again when we start talking about warrant articles and things that we want to get behind. I just had a thought about the... Sorry,
it'll come
escape
back.
Me.
It'll come back.
But there, we're going to have some definitely some big conversations. Like one of the ones that you mentioned about the washdown, that's something that the board has got behind many times, and sometimes they didn't get behind it, but it seems like it perennially...
It keeps on coming up.
It gets turned down by the voters.
So this is a whole new configuration on that.
We have to replace the
Yeah, this time it's about three times more than it was when it was turned down.
Yeah. We have to replace that septic receiving station.
Yeah.
And in doing that, we can economize on a washdown facility to incorporate it in there.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And get my fingers crossed that most of that will be SRF reimbursement.
Mm-hmm.
If we plan that right, we still have to put out $1 million to get it done. Mm-hmm. And the state's going to insist we do it soon, so...
Okay.
I'm not planning on approaching the state with a request that they insist, but it will
sounds
happen.
Like we're going to have some lively discussions. Number four under new business is Moore Avenue, request for resolution of traffic issues. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, we had a complaint from the folks that live on the corner of Dearborn and Moore.
Yeah.
And I provided you with some...
Yeah, we got it.
Their garage is dead center on ground zero. If they open their garage door and they step out this far, they're in the street.
Right.
It's a bad situation for them. They would like to have traffic restricted on that road somehow so that they can get in and out of their garage. As I pointed out to them, this is the sort of cut through to get down to the supermarket, Hannaford's. And the reason I think it's such a popular cut through is because there's a set of traffic lights at the end of Kershaw and Route 1. If there are a set of traffic lights at Ann's Lane and Route 1, this probably would not be a problem.
Right.
That's really the guts of all this, right. Is how do you get across Route 1 to get to the grocery mm-hmm. store without a traffic light at a particular corner? So a lot of people in town come down and they go in Moore Lane and down Hackett, now Kershaw, right. And yep. Right to the market, and you see it constantly going mm-hmm. on.
Yep.
They would like to somehow restrict that. They had talked to me about making the road one way and perhaps making the other roads one way in a different direction, so you couldn't drive through no matter what happened. I'm not sure that's a viable solution to the problem. Maybe speed bumps, maybe speed tables, maybe things of that nature. They say the people travel at a high rate of speed going down this street, but it's only three house lots long. It's not much of a street, so you can't be going too fast. But of course, the more constricted a neighborhood is, the faster it seems people are going, simply because of the environment. I really think that the solution to this is to put a traffic light at Ann's Lane and Route 1. If you really want to close this off to a lot of traffic like they have now.
So another traffic light on Route 1 is not happening.
It's not the happy thing in life.
It's not going to happen. Yeah.
And I doubt very much if the town would appropriate it.
Right.
But that leaves this road basically the way it's laid out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I've got thousands of cars that go by my property every day, and I'm not asking for a new light. And I respect the newcomers to town. And I've seen the Navy sign out on their property and the two stars, meaning they've got two people that are serving their country,
right.
And they're good people. But again, that is a time-honored, time-traveled, well-traveled route. And the traffic there is far less than many of mm-hmm. the rest of us endure.
Yeah.
Mr. Waddell.
Okay.
Mr. Bridle?
I'm set.
Mrs. Wellesley? So...
I'll write them a note.
Yeah.
Thank you. Other new business, Mr. Bridle?
Nothing.
Mrs. Wellesley? Mr.
No, thank you, sir.
Nothing.
Move to adjourn at whatever hour, Mr.
21:29.
21:29.
Second.
Have a good time. All right.
Jimmy, thanks for that work up on rooms and meals.